Welcome to the Arcane Style tutorial for Valdiani in Blender. Timestamps for each section of the video as well as a link for the Blender source file are in the description. Firstly, and most importantly, for any project, even if you want to create something unique, use reference images. They will give you really good inspiration for things you might have missed and generally get you to improve upon them. For compiling them, I recommend using PureRef, the link is in the description as well. You can simply search for the reference images in your browser and drag them into the view. As you can see, I've got some screenshots of the Valdiani, as well as some general style characteristics of the show here. Now, using these reference images, start modeling very basic shapes. You don't want to use much details first, as it will most probably not fit your final vision for the project, because something looks off compared to the rest of the object. Use basic shapes and then refine until you're happy with the result. If you'd like to follow what I'm doing on screen, in the top left corner you can see screencast keys, just in case you don't know some of the shortcuts. For this project, I first made the basic cylinder shape as seen in the reference images, then cut it up into the base and into the opening shards. For the shards, delete everything except 1/4, add a mirror modifier targeting the base, and select the y-axis as well. That way you already have 4 shards, which all move and are modified in the same way. Do the same for the legs, add the basic shapes, cut them up and add them back in using the mirror modifier. Then start extruding along the base to get the rough shape as seen in the reference images. Don't add curves or bevels yet, you want the shape to be as simple as possible. Once you're done with the outlines, you can start refining the shapes. Add edge cuts, adjust the shape until it looks how you like it. For the top part of the legs, you can extrude them upwards and add a cylinder to match the little circles you can see here. Using these principles of a simple, basic start, you can go ahead and add more details to your model. Now that you're done with the legs, you can start refining the shards further. Add a subdivision surface modifier. Then, adjust the shards for the extrusions we've made at the legs so the two objects don't clip too much. Normally, you'd want the subdivision modifier to be at the top of the modifier stack, so it applies before the mirror modifier. But now, these separated shards are exactly what we're looking for, so simply apply the subdivision surface modifier as it is. Now, we're going to create the outlines of the shards. Select the outer and inner edges of the shard, duplicate them, and separate them into their own object. Now add a skin modifier. This uses the vertices and edges we already have to create a skinned surface. In edit mode, select everything and scale using Ctrl+A until you have a small outline of the original shard. Sometimes you need to scale the whole object on the X and Y axis very slightly to get the desired result. Now we're going to want to be able to open the shards precisely. Place your 3D cursor at the point where the shards will be rotating around. Then add an empty and adjust its rotation so it's perpendicular to the shard. Parent a shard to the empty and parent the outline to the shard. Now you can control the opening of the shards using the empty. Now to the interior spinning rings. In the show, the rings appear to be clipping this main pillar here, and the Valdiani is only ever shown from below, not allowing us to see what's going on. The version we are making is more oriented at a gyroscope, with each ring being able to rotate on one extra axis. Therefore, there will be no clipping and you'll be able to view the Valdiani from any angle. Simply add a torus, duplicate it 3 times and scale each version down, add some details and we're good to go. We are going to drive the rotation of the rings using constraints, meaning there will be no keyframing and everything will be customizable. Constraints are a way to control an object's properties, like the location, rotation and scale, using either predefined limitations, like for example limiting an object's location from -1 to +1, or the more advanced way, which is using other objects. For that, the main constraint we are going to use is transformation. This constraint lets you map values from one object to another. For example, you can tell it that for every meter the targeted object moves, the object with the constraint should move a meter as well. You can also use the location of an object to influence the owner's rotation, which is what we are going to do. Create another empty in your scene and add a transformation constraint to your outer ring. Select the empty as the targeted object. Now tell it to map from the Z location to the Z rotation. I used values of 0.5 meter to 100 degrees, but you can experiment to get the result you're looking for. If you now take the empty and move it up on the Z axis, you can see the outer ring is rotating. However, after 100 degrees, it stops. Now you could adjust the location and rotation for so long that the rotation won't stop in your time frame, but there's a much easier way to do that. Simply select Extrapolate in the constraint settings. The constraint will now use your current data and practically extend it into infinity. Now for the middle ring, add another transformation constraint, this time targeting the outer ring. Extrapolate and use the Z rotation to drive the Z rotation. I used 10 degrees in both values here. Now, the middle ring will rotate exactly the same way the outer ring does. But we don't want it to only rotate on the z-axis, but also on the x-axis, in order to get the desired effect. Now that we set up the transformation constraint, this is really easy to do. Simply select the z-axis as the source for the x-axis and choose a value. I used 15 degrees here. This now means that for every 10 degrees the outer ring rotates on the z-axis, the middle ring will rotate 10 degrees on the z-axis as well as 15 degrees on the x-axis. For the inner ring we can use another method. Simply parent the inner ring to the middle ring. It now rotates the exact same way. Add a transformation constraint, extrapolate, target the middle ring and tell it that for every 10 degrees of z-rotation it should rotate 20 degrees on the z-axis. But since the inner ring is now using the rotation of the middle ring, this doesn't work as expected. This is because the inner ring is using global coordinates, but we wanted to use the local coordinates of the parented object. Simply select local space under the owner category of the constraint and you will have a working gyroscope. Now we could animate the opening of the shards and the rising of the ring separately, but for convenience we're going to use the same method of transformation constraints being driven by the animation empty. Drive the Y rotation of the shard empty using the Z location of the animation empty. I used half a meter to 115 degrees. Now the animation empty controls the rotation of the rings as well as the opening of the shards. The only thing missing is the rising of the rings. As you might have guessed, use the Z location of the animation empty to drive to the Z location of the outer ring. For the middle ring, add a copy location constraint. Target the outer ring and enable offset. The inner ring is already parented to the middle ring, so we don't need a constraint here. Now, the animation empty drives every movement of the Valdiani. Simply animate empty going up and down and you've got yourself the finished animation. Now that we're done with the technical part of the tutorial, let's continue with the artistic part. We're going to paint the textures onto the object. For this, we could use the Blender Texture Paint tool, but other image editors are simply much more powerful and intuitive. I'm going to use Krita, but you can use whichever program you might prefer. Now we could take a viewport render and import it into the paint program, but there's a much easier way. In the Blender Preferences under File Paths, Applications, paste the path of the executable file of your image editor. Now, create a new image using a base color and plug it into the color input. Enter the texture paint mode. Under the end panel, tools, scroll down to options, choose a resolution, I recommend at least 1K if not 2K, and select quick edit. Now your image editor will open and show you the same view of the object you had when you press quick edit. Add a new layer and you can start painting the texture. For this and really every other thing regarding digital painting, I recommend using a graphics tablet. The ability to use pen pressure and overall the natural feeling of painting with a pen will save you so much frustration and make your paintings instantly better. It doesn't have to be an expensive one. I'm using the Gaumon MK10 Pro, which only cost me 65 euros and I'm very satisfied with it. Now, for the Arcane style, I cannot stress enough to look at lots and lots of reference images. Start by painting a simple layered background using different shades of the same color, then add in the details you would like to have using basic colors. I recommend using new layers for each iteration because it allows for much more flexibility. Once you're done with the basic colors, you can start to add in some highlights and roughnesses. In Arcane, nothing is perfect, everything has some kind of variation, irregularity or damage, so keep that in mind while painting. Add some color variations, size differences, scratches and other imperfections to your image to make it look more convincing. Once you're done, hide the layer with the original image, press Ctrl+Shift+S and save the image. When it asks you to overwrite the file, press yes, as it will overwrite the original quick edit image and use your new custom one. In Blender, select apply and you will now have your painted texture on the object. In the shader editor, you can use that image and convert it to a grayscale black and white image using a color ramp. With this, you can drive the roughness and specular of the principal PSDF shader. You can even use it as height information in a bump node for custom normal map. You can play around with the black and white sliders on the color ramp and the strength of the bump node to match what you're looking for. These adjustments make the texture look more three-dimensional and add easy but beautiful details. For the lighting, I'm using three area lights, all pointed at the middle of the inner ring. To give the shapes a bit more contrast, I use slightly colored lights. The key light is slightly yellow and the fill and backlights are both slightly different shades of blue. Now, switch to the Cycles render engine, enable denoise in the viewport and render settings, place your camera and render your image. The compositor allows you to enhance and adjust an image. In the compositor window, check Use Nodes. Press Ctrl+Shift+Left-click on your render layer and you will get a view node to see what you're doing. You will see a rendered image in the background. To move the image, hold Alt and move your middle mouse button, and scale using V and Alt V. The first note we're going to add is a glare note. Set it to fog low and you will get a bloom effect similar to the one in Eevee. Since Cycles is a ray tracing engine, we can't have bloom as a tickable box and we need to add it in via the compositor. Then you can add an RGB curves note and adjust the value slightly to brighten or darken the image and increase the contrast between light and dark. Don't use too high values or your image will look bad quickly. Then we're going to add in a lens distortion note. With this you can, well, distort your image, but way more useful, you can add chromatic aberration. Chromatic aberration is an effect that occurs in real camera lenses and is basically the failure of the lens to focus all color on the same point, resulting in different locations for different wavelengths of the light. In the dispersion input, use a very low value, I used 0.0175, and you will notice the subtle chromatic aberration on the edges of the image as well as in dark areas. To fix now slightly distorted image, check fit. You can also enable jitter to give the image some more imperfections. Using all these tips I've given you in this video, you can create your own environment surrounding the Valdiani we created in this video. If you'd like to have the source files of the final result, you can download it on my Gumroad, the first link is in the description. If you've got any questions or feedback, feel free to let me know in the comments. That's it, thank you for your attention, I hope you learned something.